Well, welcome back to the Christ Center Cosmic Civilization, and we're doing a deep dive on angels and archangels and all the principalities and powers of the heavens, and looking at scriptures. And we're always wanting to say Christ is the center of attention, but under Christ, we're just having a little bit of a thought about what the Bible tells us about angels and archangels and all the company of heaven things. And also, we're just having an awareness that there are books that are like adjacent to what I call the Bible that have a lot to say about it, books that even get quoted in the Bible. And then there's this kind of traditions, like we've thought about Dionysius the Areopagite, who had a whole structure of that for us to think about. And I think in the end, we've concluded Dionysius is pretty good. And even if some of his stuff has been corrupted by those horrible Neoplatonists, nevertheless, we can sort of extract from here that his original thought, which is full of good stuff. We've still got PJ with us, who's like part of the Global Church History Project. And he produces a lot of materials for that. And his books are always coming out. And I can't wait for this. Candlemas one is the one that's going to come out soon. And that started off as a little book, but it's huge now. And it's got even recipes and things in it, the last I heard. But anyway, the one we're really thinking about is his book called Michaelmas, Down Through Church History. And you can that's available. You can get it through Amazon and things, I think. But what we're thinking, what we'd like to think about now is draw our attention back to the archangels particularly. And one of the things I was fascinated about in the book was the names of the archangels. Like I know in the Bible, we've got the archangel Michael and there's the archangel Gabriel. Like I'm fine with that in the Bible. But first of all, I'd like him to tell us, how do we definitely know there are seven archangels? Because I'm like, there's two. I've got two in my Bible. And one of the things that PJ says is, nah, in the Bible, there are seven. In the Bible, there are seven, like, of these. So I'd like him to, first of all, help us to understand the sevenness of the archangels. And is that really in the Bible? And then, what about the names of them? How sure are we? And does everyone agree what the seven names of the archangels are? Well, let's start in the order. First of all, how do we know? How confident can we be from the Bible, as I understand the Bible anyway, that there are seven archangels? So a key part of this is when we look at Revelation and Zechariah, because Revelation has a lot of the same themes as Zechariah. But in particular, we see the seven spirits that stand before the throne of God. Some translation, although very few, but some have it as sevenfold, which it can't be really, because the word used in Revelation is hepta, where sevenfold is either heptakis or heptaplasius. So heptaplasion, that appears in Isaiah 30:26, where it says the sun in the new creation, it will shine, its light will be sevenfold. So seven times what it used to be. But we see heptakis when Cain, it said he will be avenged sevenfold. So sevenfold is a concept in the Bible, and it uses those words, and it doesn't use it of these spirits that stand before the throne of God. And then we also see the spirits that stand before the throne of God. They're mentioned in Zechariah 6:5, which mentions four of them. But then we see that there's seven overall in Revelation. But we see four of them, and they appear early. So it's mentioned they're the spirits that stand before the throne of God, and it mentions the horses they ride on. And then knowing that, we see that Zechariah 1:8 was talking about them, and there they're given a report to Jesus, which is I love that particular passage. So we have in mind who the ones who stand before the throne are. They're these seven, and then we see four of them elsewhere. But then when we go forward to like at Revelation 8, In Zechariah 4:10, is it, where it says the seven eyes of the Lord that run... Yeah. Is that one?
Yeah, that is referencing, and that we can see as well, it says the seven spirits that stand before the throne of God, Revelation says, are the seven eyes of the Lamb.
So should I just read Zechariah 4:10? It says, the seven eyes of the Lord that run to and fro throughout the whole earth. So that seven eyes of the Lord, you're saying Revelation actually specifies that those are these seven spirits, seven angels that have this great authority to represent the Lord throughout the earth.
Yes.
So Zechariah 4:10, carry on with your Revelation ones.
Yeah, so in Revelation 8:2, it says that you have seven angels which stand before God. So the ones who stand before God, we have seven before they're called spirits. And then in 8:2, it says the ones that stand before God are angels. And we have that in mind. And then it mentions how the ones that stand before God, they're given trumpets. And then they're given vials. And then we go further in Revelation to...
And there's always seven trumpets and seven vials, isn't there? Yeah.
So it is these angels that stand before God, who are the seven spirits. They have... And they have seven bowls, seven vials, or, you know... in Revelation 7:1, we see that one of those seven standers comes and speaks with John, and then he gives him a tour of heaven, just like he did Enoch long before. Then, when we go over to Revelation 19, John reckons one of these seven is God, so he tries to worship him, and then this angel tells him off. So we can see why we want it to be the sevenfold spirit, because we've seen that the spirit is sevenfold and we see it in the menorah. But then noticing what Philo says, that the sevenfoldness of the spirit goes into these creatures. And so that kind of starts in heaven in a way, that we have these seven archangels that are represented by these lamps that we see as the planets in some strange way. The spirit gives them this kind of life and authority, but they are not God and they should not be worshipped. And that takes us to, again, like a couple of podcasts ago, we were saying how we've got to not worship the angels. And no matter how much we talk about them and we hold them in honor, never worship. And so this particular angel, yeah.
Now, I know there's a reference that I've got from something called the Book of Tobit. Now, what is that? Is that another one of these ones that's from an apocryphal book? And and in that one, it seems to be this archangel who is disguised himself as a human, and then he reveals who he really is, and it turns out he's an archangel. Is that a first summary?
That is.
And then what's going on? And what is it worth reading Tobit for those of us who have a smaller Bible than that one?
It's another one of those where we see, in the very least, allusions, and some people say direct quotations from the New Testament of Tobit. And it's one of those, once you read it, you're like, oh, you notice some part of the New Testament you might not have like fully thought like where they're getting that from. A lot of the times it's Tobit. Also, that particular phrase, when he reveals himself, he says, I am Raphael, one of the seven archangels who stand before the Lord. So again, we see how that connects with Revelation. He says, there are these seven angels that stand before the Lord, and he expects you to know about them. Raphael does as well. And then in Luke's account of the Nativity, we see the Archangel Gabriel appear to Zechariah. So this is earlier on, and I'm trying to find it in my Bible. I've got it in paper. I like seeing it, you know. There we go. Chapter 1, verse 19. The angel answering said unto him, I am Gabriel that stand in the presence of God. So it's a very similar turn of phrase. So he says the Lord in Tobit, whereas Gabriel says God in Luke. But of course, we know they are basically synonymous terms. They introduce themselves in the same way.
So one of the seven archangels who stand before the Lord, Gabriel speaks like that in Luke. Mm. And then this guy is called Raphael, and he is there this Tobit, Book of Tobit 12:15. Now, it's a fascinating story from what I can tell, where there's, he's kind of disguised himself and then as a human, and then he reveals himself to be an archangel. And that idea that Hebrews talks about, that you could invite somebody in and give them hospitality, and it turns out that that was actually an angel secretly disguised, that fits with the Tobit story, really. And I've heard it said that that verse in Hebrews is thinking of the book of Tobit, where the angels may be disguised as humans. Now, but let's not get distracted by that. The thing I want to focus on is he tells you his name, that he's Raphael. So Michael, we know. Gabriel, we know from them just straightforward Bible. Here's a guy, here's one who calls himself Raphael. I've heard that, like, Michael means who is like God. And you earlier were saying that he is the one who kind of, when Satan, he fights against Satan, because Satan says, I'm going to be like God. And it's as if Michael goes, who's like God except God? You know, and so he, maybe that's how he got his name. It's like, he's like, who's like God except God? And it's like, ah, let's call him Michael, because that's what he does. And then Gabriel is like the power of God. That's what that means. And then you see that, like, in the incarnation and things like that, where there's that, by this work and power of God to become incarnate and things like that. And this Holy Spirit is so, like, seems to go with Gabriel. Like, Gabriel seems to represent the Spirit in a way. Michael seems to represent the Son, as we've already mentioned that, God the Son. But Raphael... Raphael, as far as I can tell, means something like the healing of God. Now then, in John 5, do you want to talk about this? John 5, 4, there's a strange thing, and it isn't even in everyone's Bible. Some Bibles edit out verse 4 of John chapter 5, but do you want to tell us what it says? And then, is this, could this be? Anyway, you find John chapter 5, verse 4, what does it say? Well, it's a, John, you could read, it's about this incident where there's a person who needs to be healed, and they're at this pool, and the pool's called the Pool of
Bethesda.
Bethesda. And anyone who gets down to the water first gets miraculously healed. And you might say, well, that can't be true. But actually, the Bible provides an explanation. John chapter 5, is it verse 4?
Yeah, it is. Well, because here I have a revised version of the King James, so they've gotten rid of it, but they've footnoted it, so I can still
read
it.
And I have it on, I've put it here, yeah.
Yes, so, yeah, the version that they've edited out, it says, they were waiting for the moving of the water, for an angel of the Lord went down at certain seasons into the pool and troubled the water. Whosoever then first after the troubling of the water stepped in was made whole. With whatsoever disease he was holden.
So there it is. An angel, the Bible says, an angel would go down at certain times, stir up the water, first into the water, gets healed of whatever disease they had. Now, because the name Raphael means the healing of God, is that, could that be Raphael?
A lot of people say it is, and it makes sense. And a lot of people feel you can be, if you want to stick with a shorter canon, there are ways you can explain these things, and you can see the names and everything and how they get it from your shorter canon. If you want to, because there are a lot of people who feel like, no, I've just got to make sure everyone knows this is scripture, and so I don't want to, like, rock the boat. And so if you do want to do it, there's still, you can see that there is...
There is an angel that seems to have special healing powers and responsibilities. So even if you go, I don't know if it's Raphael, I don't know if it's an archangel, and I'm a bit like that, I must admit, I'm a bit like, stick to this straightforward canon of the Bible. So, but I can see that obviously is an angel who's given this great authority and has sort of special healing responsibilities. I'm very impatient, though, of people who go, oh, they thought there was an angel. The Bible doesn't say they thought there was an angel. I really get upset when people try to explain away things in the Bible. And they do that with, like, oh, Jesus with a packed lunch, he inspired people to share their packed lunches. Or they'll go, the Dead Sea, crossing the Red Sea. It was very shallow water, and they just went, and I'm like, oh, shut up. Like, don't, like, either believe it or don't believe it. But here it just says, the scriptures say, an angel did come down from time to time to trouble the water. Because otherwise, if that wasn't happening, what are all these people hanging about waiting for if there was no healing to be had at all at the waters? And then Jesus doesn't contradict it at all, and he does heal. So to me, I take that just totally literally. There is an angel who has got special healing powers, who stirred that water. Straightforward, there it is. And I can understand then, given that the name Raphael means the healing God, even though that's not told us in the Bible there, you can see why it's easy to go, oh, it could be Raphael, I get that.
And now, it's a common thing in a lot of like commentaries and so on to have names, because if you always refer to someone by a long-winded title, it's like, oh, the angel who dipped his toe and all of that. It just takes ages. So people often come up with names like the thief on the cross. They often call him Dismas. And, you know, they come up with these names, which means what we see them do in the Bible.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, and then now then, let's like, so I'm very happy with Michael and Gabriel. I'm I'm okay with Raphael. I get that one. What about this next one? Because there's four that pretty much, is it fair to say, in all the Christian traditions around the world, these first four names, there's fairly much unanimity, is it fair to say, about what are the names of the first four? And in PJ's book, he breaks all this down, and there's a chart of the names of them and what different parts of the world have different views. Now, the first four, there's one other that everyone seems to be pretty united on, and that's a guy called Uriel or Uriel. What's that? But what does his name mean? And where are we getting that name from?
So that means the flame of God. And so if that he is the one that we saw in Enoch and Esdras, he's the one who educates. And so he teaches people the word and reads scripture to them. And he's a scribe as well. And so there's a lot we can think about the flame being kind of in scripture and so on from that.
And is he sounds like, because was he the one who takes them to show them hell and things?
Yeah.
Oh, so he's like quite a fire. He's like into judgment and things, isn't
he? Yeah, he is. But of course, very patient. We see in Revelation, they're always asking, is that, oh, is it time yet? And then, you know, God's being like, no, you got to hold on still. So he's obviously patient, but he has got this authority to judge. And once it's time to judge, he doesn't hold back.
And does he, like, just as we maybe spot Raphael popping up in John 5, verse 4, is there anywhere where Uriel, like from this flaming archangel, does he pop up anywhere in the Bible?
Yeah, in Revelation, and because Revelation, when it starts off by saying this is sent from John and Jesus and the seven spirits, the seven holy archangels, they send their greetings, and they possibly consider themselves kind of co-authors of Revelation, which is one of the incredible things about the book, because we see co-authors in Paul's letters, and it's like, you know, Timothy also says hi, and then John kind of pulling rank. He's like, well, Jesus and the seven holy archangels say hi, they send this book. But yeah, when we see these holy archangels, they're given these bowls, and they pour it out on earth, and one of them stands in the sun. And so when you think you've got this flame of God, and then and it says he's given charge over all fire.
Where's that? You carry on talking a minute, and I'll find that one for you.
Okay. Yes, I've got these references in the book, but bouncing over these passages, it does take a while. But he's got charge over.
It's Revelation 19:17. Were open at the right page, and I knew you couldn't just see it. Revelation 19:17.
Yes, and so you've got him, it's one standing in the sun, and the sun's like often called like fiery and flamey, and that's not just like a revelation thing. You can see it yourself. the sun is like that.
Do you want to read that for us? And it's pretty ominous stuff. If this angel definitely is into judgment and bringing the fire of judgment, really. Good. Yes. If you read this to us, and then we'll see that.
And I saw an angel standing in the sun, and he cried with a loud voice, saying to all the birds that fly in mid-heaven, come and be gathered together unto the great supper of God, that ye may eat the flesh of kings, and the flesh of captains, and the flesh of mighty men, and the flesh of horses, and of them that sit thereon, and the flesh of all men, both free and bond, and small and great.
Wow. So there we are. There's the, that is an angel that is fire, and is into judgment. And that you're saying that does seem to be the case with this guy called Uriel.
Yeah.
And that just means the fire of God.
Yeah.
So, again, you could see why, if you were going to name the angel mentioned in Revelation, you'd probably say, well, we're going to have to call him Uriel, aren't we? The fire of God.
Yeah, right. Absolutely.
And he's mentioned in Esdras is a book, because I know that the Anglicans, with the Book of Common Prayer, do have quotations from this apocryphal work.
Yeah.
And they do have quotations from, like, Esdras and Enoch and things, is it?
Enoch isn't in the Anglican one, although seems like people like Milton and so on.
Oh, Milton, like, you know. But I know that you say that the Anglican tradition does use Dionysius.
Yeah.
And so I do like Dionysius, I have to say. So, and then maybe it's because I'm an Anglican. But the Anglicans do have two Esdras as, like, in the Book of Common Prayer and things.
Yeah. And Uriel
is. And Uriel's in there.
Yeah. He's mentioned by name. He's the one that shows Ezra, because Ezra, again, he cares a lot about the Bible, and he founds the scribes. And even though they've gone wrong by the time of Jesus, obviously, when it starts off with Ezra, the scribes are great. And Uriel is said to be a scribe himself in heaven. So, there's quite strong tradition. And so you see, like, it's interesting noticing what kind of concepts the Bible links together, and being a scribe and being fiery. We might think of scribes, and maybe our intellectuals aren't fiery.
Very rarely.
But in scripture, obviously, the people who keep in charge of the word of God, they've got to be fiery kind of people.
Nice.
And that's who Ezra kind of was. And we see that he knew Uriel, and Uriel shows him a lot of great stuff.
There's another angel. I know now we're going to get... Well, let's deal with the complexity that there are three more, but they... There's a lot of disagreement about the names of the next three. There's one that I can feel is, again, sort of mentioned in the Bible. Because in Revelation chapter 8, there's an angel that gathers up the prayers of the saints and has them like an incense in a bowl. And one of the names given for this fifth archangel is something like Salaphiel, which kind of means prayers of God.
Yes.
Prayers of God. So again, I can imagine, is that there in Revelation 8?
Yeah, it is. Yeah. And another angel came and stood over the altar, having under him much incense, that he should add it unto the prayers of all the saints upon the golden altar, which was before the throne. And he takes the censer and he fills it with fire and casts it on the earth. So we see the seven do that thing where they throw things on earth.
So they have got administration over the earth. But then that one, if there is an archangel who kind of seems to work on this business of communication from the saints to heaven, like he's involved in that. Because if Salaphiel just means the prayers of God... I could imagine, I can buy that name too, and I can sort of imagine he's the one mentioned there.
And in the Byzantine traditions, they do, and in Spanish ones and Portuguese ones, they like using these names that are kind of like Dismas and so on. Like, it's kind of inferred in scripture, or it's like you could just say it is based on the Bible. Whether or not that's the name he goes by, it's accurate, you know, in that sort of way. Just from what we're told in scripture. So they kind of go with those ones rather than any kind of traditional names. So those ones kind of make sense and you can see them in the Bible.
All of those five, I'm sort of, even if I'm not absolutely sure Raphael, Uriel and Slephiel, that is the name, it could be, but they certainly make sense that what they do, there are angels that seem to be described by that name. What about these last two? I've got the names here and I've gone with the...
Byzantine, I believe.
Yeah, I've got Byzantine names or something on my screen, but Can you give us, like, who, give us these two, there's two more. Can you explain, so why is there such diversity in, like, you've got in your book, like, Ethiopian traditions, Iberian, Anglican, Coptic, and then sort of Roman Catholic.
Yeah.
Why is there such a range of views, particularly on these final, on five, six, and seven?
So, in the early church and the Dead Sea Scrolls, they seem to agree, as I said, with Enoch. So they mention these Enochic names relatively fine.
So what are the Enochic names for these last three?
You've got the basic four, obviously, Michael, Gabriel, Raphael, Uriel. But then you've got Remiel, Raguel, Serachiel, and then Fanuel sometimes as well. There's a 7+1 thing. A lot of them have a little bonus guy he tags on. They kind of all seem to agree on that as well, which is an odd thing.
And just on that little bit, while you've, now that you've just mentioned that, there is a tradition that has that Lucifer was one of the archangels, and there were eight.
Yeah.
And there were eight, and then he blows it.
Mm.
And so that way, the plus one is a bit like Matthias.
Yeah.
So they upgrade, another angel gets upgraded to take the place of what was Lucifer's.
And interestingly, in Enoch, that is Fanuel, who gets rid of all accusers from heaven so that no accusations make it, so that all our sins are forgiven.
Right.
He makes sure of that by getting rid of all Satan's, even, it says. You know.
Right. So the Matthias guy who replaces Judas in the heavenly realms, this Fanuel guy is like, we're not having any more accusations. So that's it. This has got to be a guilt-free zone, heaven, the highest heaven.
Mm.
Okay. So I like that Fanuel idea. But what about then? So originally in the Book of Enoch, we've got these names.
Yes.
And but there's a kind of variety going down through history and around the world about these three.
Mm.
What is the reason for that?
So when Augustine and others, you know, but he was one of the most influential voices kind of against Enoch, because he does that in the West, then they have shortened their canon a lot more. And it means they don't have it, because Enoch just gives a list of all seven. It means the West no longer has that. Then a lot of people then speculate, and sometimes they take ideas from like Kabbalah and things. So Pope Zachary says, that's it. You're not allowed to inquire about anything but the names of the angels found in scripture. But
so let me just clarify that one of the dangers then that happened is people just start to kind of either invent stuff, can just totally invent it, or they derive from totally non-Christian sources.
Yeah.
And so in the end, like, the Pope and church leaders have to go, whoa,
yeah,
this is getting out of hand. You've got to stick to really, like, either directly only scripture or these books that are kind of possibly scripture or at least adjacent to scripture, but you cannot just go wandering off into all sorts of nonsense.
And that's where those kind of biblically derived names that we're thinking about, like Jugudiel, Salathiel, and so on, and those are based on a kind of exegesis of Revelation. They become
and Barachiel just means blessing of God, doesn't
it? Yeah, or the thunderer of God. And that in particular, because you see in Revelation, there's one that he looks like a lion and he thunders something, and John tries to write it down, and then the other angel was like, no, you're not allowed.
Oh, yeah, that's right. He's
So they say whoever thunders, he's got the thunder of God in him, so we can call him Thunderer of God, and that kind of is one of those
names. So that's another way where the name is given because it describes what this mighty angel does.
Yeah.
Right.
And then Jehudiel or Jehudiel, the glory or the praise of God, because we thought about how there's that one, Salathiel, and he has a bowl of incense, because he's really representing like prayers being given to God. But then all the seven holy archangels have a bowl of incense and a harp for praise. So then they think, well, if there's one archangel dedicated towards the incense bit, there's got to be an archangel who's big on the harp. So they say, well, that one then, he's the praise of God, because it says the harps are for praising God. So he's that guy. So those exegetical kind of names pop up for that reason of trying to think like, all right, let's try and get them from Bible.
Yep.
And so they keep the name Uriel and so on because they think, well, we can base it, you know.
I like it. I mean, to me, like, I find them plausible because in each of the time, what has happened is you see an angel, a great angel in the Bible, And then it's kind of our ancestors looked and thought, now what is that great angel doing? Ah, here's a name that describes what they're doing. And then that's the name that kind of has stuck for in the Byzantine, and, you know, like huge amounts of literature and art has them and things like that. So I love all this because I got to confess, like, I've read some of these passages of scripture hundreds of times, really, and I haven't really bothered to take them seriously. I'm being honest with our audience. I've sort of, oh, there's some angel who does something. And I just feel challenged that our ancestors didn't just whiz past these scriptures, but said, whoa, there's an angel that thunders in the presence of God. And they really believe in, and this is part of the point of this podcast, the Christ-Centered Cosmic Civilization, is that as moderns, we just don't really believe that these things are real. We just are deeply indoctrinated and brainwashed into this totally flat, meaningless, materialistic view of the universe. But our Christian ancestors weren't like that. They deeply believed that there really are heavenly creatures doing it in things, and that the scriptures give us these little glimpses into it, not so we become obsessed with these things, but just so we know, like, there's levels of reality going on and angels doing extraordinary, wonderful things, and that the whole universe, the heavens and the earth, is being administered by the Lord Jesus Christ through these delegated creatures that have authority and responsibilities. And it makes me filled with wonder and awe that the cosmos is full of such wonders, and to meet these creatures that do these wonderful works. And this sense that when people in the Bible, like Daniel and Ezekiel and John and others, and Moses seems to encounter the whole lot, he seems to have seen everything, that you can see why they're so awestruck by the wonders of the heavenly realms, and most of all by the Lord himself. These are the people that are really deeply filled with fear of the Lord, love of the Lord, deep worship. So it's somehow that, like, to understand these great angels and the holy work that they do, if we're doing it in a right way, a biblical way, that makes us worship the Lord God more, have more fear, more wonder, more sense of his glory and the way and his ways. So that's what we'll leave that for this episode. We'll do, I think, one more episode on this matter of archangels, and we want to know how does this understanding of archangels show up in the church year, feasts and festivals to do with angels. How could maybe we want to get this in our churches and think, I want to make sure this is part of our church life, to take seriously angels. How can we do that?